True Islam. Myth. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful. In medieval times, the unwavering belief that the world was flat led to riots, isolation, and even death to those who dared contest this fallacy. Misconceptions and myths can be dangerous. Today, this same ignorance and intolerance has led to a backlash against Islam and Muslims.
Unfortunately, Muslims and Islam have been introduced to the Western civilizations and to the common people and the scholars through tragedies and wars. The Islamic religion has been hijacked by the terrorists. And we have to be very careful not to come to label the Muslims as terrorists, because that's not true, not in the history, not today.
Contention and debate surround images of jihad and perceptions of the role and status of women in Islam. Since the tragic events of September the 11th, the most prevalent myth about Islam is that it encourages violence. Many scholars, politicians and media repeatedly associate Islam with terror. Islam is a peace-promoting religion and takes a strong and clear stand against the killing of non-combatants. According to the Quran, the Holy Book of Islam,
if anyone killed a person not in retaliation of murder or to spread mischief in the land, it would be as if he killed all mankind.
As with any society, not all citizens follow the codes and teachings of Islam. Fanatical interpretations of Islam are not representative of the religion and its teachings. The actions of a militant few can in no way represent the beliefs of over 1 billion people. As with the abuse of children by some Catholic priests, these actions should not implicate all Catholics. Those who claim to kill or harm innocent civilians in the name of Islam are not true Muslims. There is much misunderstanding of the term jihad, often misinterpreted as holy war.
Holy war is a Christian concept, not a Muslim concept, developed during the Crusades in the Middle Ages. Now, jihad means literally to do your best. And therefore there is jihad in terms of thinking, there is jihad in terms of action. Now it has taken a particular view, meaning a military action against the other, but it doesn't have to be. And the highest form of jihad is jihad of the self, that is self-control.
Concerning jihad for the sake of Allah, jihad is not only practiced by the sword, or pistols, or cannons, or planes. Jihad is also practiced with the pen, with the tongue, through the advice one gives, or a lecture, and even through charity to other Muslims. There are many kinds of jihad.
As stated in the Holy Quran,
permission is given to fight those who are fought against, because they have been wronged, and surely Allah is able to give them victory.
Many more misconceptions about Islam relate to women. Wearing the veil is a requirement on all Muslim women, and the Quran commands it.
What you don't see is what you don't want. And the thing is that we have to understand that it's not oppression that we're making our women cover. Because when she's at home, she's not, you know, it's not that she's all covered. It's only when she's out in the street. You know, how many people actually really, you know, although it's common in the West, you know, for people to, you know, shake other men's wives' hands and to dance with other men's wives and to hug other men's wives, but that's a step in the wrong direction, you know what I'm saying? Because if you let somebody hug your wife, then he's actually in a position that you belong to. It's your position that he's taking.
Following this requirement is, however, a woman's personal choice, not that of her husband or father as believed. Cassandra, who has converted to Islam, shares her thoughts.
We're in the, there is also history, because I can see, looking back in time, that if somebody looks at me, they can have a why. Why would somebody do that? And it's understandable because these societies and cultures have gone so far the other way that the idea of morality and having manners or having being shy or being modest, these are like concepts that no longer exist, especially in the Western culture. So something that happened to me gradually, and actually when I first became Muslim, I told my husband one day, I said, I want to be Muslim, I want to pray, I want everything in Islam, but don't expect me to put anything on my head. That's like my own conceptions at that time were so far as like why it would be necessary. Because when somebody really believes, when they really say La ilaha illallah wa Muhammadan Rasulullah, that's the first step.
Bathing is a social aristocratic custom that was practiced during the life of the Prophet, and it started with the wives of the Prophet being veiled, and everyone in society wanted to imitate them and became a social religious practice.
Actually, what happened to me is why I covered my face totally. So I come to the point where, as myself personally, it's like I want to increase my faith and I want to get as close to Allah as I can. I can't memorize Quran. I mean, as maybe a Westerner, and the language is so far from me. So memorizing Quran and feeling that feeling is kind of hard for me. And even the language in Arabic, I don't know, as foreigners, we have a hard time reading books. So to me, it's like I want to do the Sunnah. And that's how I saw it first. It's like there's in Islam, the more we do Sunnah, the closer we get to Allah and His Prophet.
Another highly critical issue surrounds Islam's concession to marry more than one wife. Although polygamy is permitted, most Muslims practice this in cases of extreme necessity, and even then, the Quran demands we conform to very strict conditions set by God, as stated in the Holy Quran.
And if you fear that you shall not be able to deal justly with the orphan girls, then marry women of your choice, two or three or four. But if you fear that you shall not be able to deal justly with them, then only one.
The option is still there, and this option has to be ordered in a very strict way so men cannot misuse this option. Because originally it was allowed for causes such as sickness, war, death and other things, so women could be taken care of in the absence of men.
Today, the practice is not so common. Yasmin explains.
I respect polygamy, of course, but I wouldn't choose it for myself. And when I got married, I asked my husband to write it in the contract because it's my right to do so. I asked him to say that if I get married, if he gets married to another woman, I get divorced automatically. Because I'm the jealous type, simply. But I respect it because there are situations where it is very important, like at times of war, times of when there is an increase in women and a decrease in the number of men, etc. There are specific times when the woman is barren, but the men and women love each other, etc. So there are specific cases where it really works.
Although a woman has the right to marry only one man, when it comes to divorce, the Quran grants women the same rights as men. Although not encouraged, Islam does permit divorce on certain grounds. If the man is at fault and refuses to release his wife, she can demand a separation and bring an end to suffering a hostile relationship. While circumcision of men is mandatory, circumcision of women is not. Female genital mutilation is an unimaginable violation and is not an Islamic practice, as some may believe. It is based on social and cultural traditions rather than on religious teachings. Yana is a 25-year-old Christian woman from a village in North Africa.
I was circumcised as a very young girl. It was common practice in my village. My mother would have been ostracized if she had tried to interfere.